Hello and good afternoon to all. Am I audible to you? Am I audible to you? Anyone can reply? Yes, thank you. So, dear student, we will start our today's online session. Okay, of operating system and administration. Okay. In the last week, we have started the unit number 3, the structure of the process. You can see the screen, the unit number 3, the structure of the process is already shared with you. So far in this unit, we have seen article like process, state and transition. So what is the process, state and transition? How many states are there? How process can change from one state to another state? That all things are explained with the help of this article, process, state and transition. How many states are there? Can anybody reply? How many states are there? Process is having how many states? How many states are there? Can anybody reply how many states are there? Process states. I am asking about the process states. 9 states are there. Very good. So 9 states are there. As you can see on your screen, these 9 states are given. The complete set of the process states like executing in the user mode, executing in the kernel mode, ready to run, slipping in memory, ready to run but in swap space, slipping in swap space, preempted, newly created, and the last one is the zombie state. Okay, these all are the 9 states of the process. Every process gone through any one of these states while completing its execution. Okay, then next, what is the state transition diagram? So here you can see on your screen the complete state transition diagram is shown. State transition diagram. Okay, so what is this? You can observe the 9 state. Whatever the 9 state are shown earlier, that are explained with the help of this state transition diagram. Isse kya kehte hai? State transition diagram. Iska matlab kya hai ki how the process can change from one state to other state. So from where to start? From where to start the explanation? From which state we can start the explanation? That is state number 8. State number 8, absolutely right. State number 8 is shown here. That is nothing but a created state, fork system called. Fork system called is used to create the process. And once the process is created, then either the process can have the enough memory for its execution, or the process will not have enough memory for completing its execution. So depending upon these two scenario, the process can go to the ready to run state or to the swap state. Okay, so all these things we have explained and we have discussed in the earlier week, in the previous week. Okay, like this, the state transition means the process can change from one state to other state. Okay, then after this state transition diagram, the explanation is given here. All these things are explained here that we have seen. What is a zombie state? What is a zombie state? Can anybody explain what is a zombie state? What is a zombie state? And then two important kernel data structures are there. First one is the process table entry and UArea. Okay, process table and UArea are the two kernel data structure that are playing a very important role for execution of the process. So what the process table contains? Process table contains these 7 fields. Okay, 9 fields. So here, see here, it contains the field that allows the kernel to locate the process. Then several user identifier like UID and PID. It contains the event descriptor, scheduling parameter, signal field, and various timers that gives the process execution time and kernel resource utilization. So all these things are present in the process table.
Sorry.
So process table contains these fields that we have seen in the previous classes. Then the second kernel data structure is the U area. So what the U area contains? U area contains a pointer to the process table, then real and effective user ID, timer fields, array indicate how process wish to react with signal, control terminal field identifiers, error field, return value, input output parameter that describes the amount of data transfer, current directory, user file descriptor table, limit field, and permission modes that are nothing but the contents of this U area table. Okay, this already we have discussed in detail in the previous classes. Okay, then after this state transition, the article layout of the system memory, this also we discussed in the previous classes, where you have to remember that how this virtual address is translated into physical address. So here the concept of the region comes in picture. So what is the region? Region is the continuous area of the virtual address space. Okay, in a Unix system, where the system divides its virtual address space in logically separated regions. So regions, what is the regions? Region are the continuous area of virtual address space. Okay, and a region is logically distinct object which can be shared, and normally there are text region, data region, and the stack region. Okay, these are the three separate regions, and it is common to share the text region among the instance of same processes. And then there is a one more very interesting table that is called as the per process region table, that is also known as pregen table, pregen. So what is this per process region table? Every process, keep in mind, every process is having its own per process region table. So that is explained with the help of this figure. You can see process A and process B are shown in this figure, process A and process B. Both these processes are having its per process region table. Now what this per process region table contains? This contains the virtual address. Virtual address of the text region, virtual address of the data region, and the virtual address of the stack region. Okay, and then this per process region table is pointing towards the actual region. Okay, that is the continuous address space, okay, where the text, data, or stack is located, that can be pointed by this per process region table. So this also we discussed in the earlier classes, where you can see the region table contains the physical location. What is this region? This region on the right hand side, that contains the physical location at which the region is spread, at which the region is spread. And each process contains the per process region table, that is called as pregen. And what it contains? The pregen entry contains a pointer to an entry in the region table. Okay, that contains the pointer to an entry in the region table. Okay, so this also we discussed. Then come the pages and the page table. Okay, so what happened in a memory model which is based on the pages? The physical memory is divided into equal size block, that is called as pages. And the page size is usually between 512 bytes to 4 kilobytes. Okay, and it's defined by the hardware, so it can change by hardware to hardware. Okay, page size. The memory location can be addressed by page number and the byte offset. Okay, now the same mapping, the mapping of this logical page number to the physical page number is shown here, where you can see how the logical page number 0 is actually mapped to the physical page number 177. So that is the job of this page tables where a logical page number to the physical page number mapping will take place. Okay, then here one example is shown in this figure, mapping of virtual address space to the physical address, where you can see in the figure the per process region table is explained, or it is shown the per process region table, which contains text region, data region, stack region, and then it points towards the page table, where page table contains the actual physical address. Okay, and these things are explained with the help of one example. Then the kernel layout, the next article is the kernel layout. Okay, this also we have seen in the previous class, kernel layout. So where actual the kernel table are pointing towards the page table, that means a changing mode from user to kernel, how the user mode is changed to the kernel mode, that is explained with the help of this article, layout of the kernel. Okay, so where you can see the example is given with the help of this figure. Then comes the U area. Okay, again, how this U area is actually map, that is a memory map of the U area in the kernel. Memory map of the U area in the kernel is explained here. Okay, and then today we are going to start the new article, that is the context of the process. Yahan tak humne last week we have seen all these articles. Now today I am going to start a new article, that is the context of the process. Context of the process. Okay, so what is the context? First question comes, what is mean by context? Context of the process. Okay, can anybody reply? What is mean by context of the process? Can anybody reply in the chat box? Yes, Prathamesh, you are absolutely right. The last state occurring when exit call get executed, that is called as a zombie state. So the Prathamesh has replied in the chat box, what is mean by zombie state? That is absolutely right. Now my next question is, what is mean by context? Can anybody reply? What is a context? What do you understand by the context? Yuraj is saying that the current state of the process. Okay, current state of the process. So then Prathamesh is again saying that it stores the text value of the global variable user and the kernel stack. Siddhant is saying that it contains the text, data, stack frame of the process. Okay, so if you remember, in the unit number 2 also, we have seen this context of the process. Okay, very briefly I explained there what is the context of the process. That is, that we have seen, if you remember, there is a very small part in unit number 2. Now in unit number 3 we are going to discuss it detail. So see, whatever the answers are given by these students are absolutely right. Okay, so see, you can see on your screen what is the context of the process. The context of the process consists of contents of its user address space, that is called as user level context. Then it contains the hardware register called the register context. Then it contains the kernel data structure that relate to the process called system context. Okay, clear? Very clearly you can see on the screen the meaning of the context, what it contains are given and explained here. So three things are very important. See, I'm highlighting it. The first one is the content. It consists of context of the process. Context of the process consists of contents of its user address space called user level context. Iska matlab kya hai? Okay, what is the meaning of this? See, I'm trying to highlight it. Okay, see. So first line, read the first line first of all. What the context of the process contains. What is given there? What the context of the process contains? It contains the user address space that is called as user level context. Secondly, it contains the hardware register that is called as register context. And lastly, it contains the kernel data structure that relates to the process called system context. Now, what is the first? User level context contains of user address space. Whatever the things are there in the user address space. Now, what is there in the user address space? User address space contains the user level instruction and user level data. Okay. User level instruction and user level data are nothing but the contents of user address space. Or usi ko kya kehte hai? User level context. Second one, it contains the hardware registers. That is called as register context. Now, what are the hardware registers in the computer organization CO? You have learned what are the hardware registers. Whatever the hardware registers, like your general purpose register, then your program counter, then your test register, debug register, all these things are there. So the contents of the hardware register are nothing but a register level context. And next one is the kernel data structure that relate to the process. Now, all you know, what are the kernel data structure? Can anybody reply? What are the example of kernel data structure? What are the kernel data structures? What are the kernel data structures? Iske bare mein kon batayega? What are the kernel data structure? File subsystem, process subsystem, inode, file table, then inode table, file descriptor table, not only related to the file, but process control subsystem, it contains the process table in tree. Then your per process region table, U area table, all these are nothing but the kernel data structure. Okay. So kernel data structure that relates to the process called system context. So samajh mein aaya aapko, what is the context, what it contains? It contains very important three points. Okay. User level context, register level context, and system level context. Okay. Now next, see here, user level context. The first one, user level context consists of process text data, user stack, and shared memory that is in the virtual address space of the process. Okay. User level mein kya rehta hai? What is the contents of user level context? So here, these things are highlighted. See, it contains the process text data, user stack, and shared memory that is in the virtual address space of the process. These things are there in the user level context. Okay. The first one is process text data, user stack, and shared memory that is in the virtual address space of the process. The part which resides on swap space is also the part of user level context. Here, the part which resides on the swap space is also the part of user level context. Okay. So these are the contents of user level context. Then you can see the next one is the register context. The register context, second point, register context. It contains the following components. What are the components of the register context? Here, it contains a program counter specifies the next instruction to be executed. So in a computer organization, you might learn the hardware register, program counter, PC, which contains the address of the next instruction. Okay. So that is called as a program counter, which specifies the next instruction to be executed. It is the address in the kernel or in the user address space. Then it contains the process status register, PS, process status register, which specifies the hardware status relating to the process. Okay. The register context contains the program counter. Second one is the process status register, which specifies the hardware status relating to the process. And it has a subfield which specify if the last instruction is overflowed, okay, or resulting in zero or positive or negative value. It also specifies the current processor execution level and current and most recent modes of execution. Okay, so that is the next field, the process status register. The next one is the stack pointer. Okay, a register contains a stack pointer. So what is the stack pointer? Here, the stack pointer that points to the current address of the next entry in the kernel or user stack. Okay, the stack pointer that points to the current address of the next entry in the kernel or user stack. So you know that what is the stack pointer? Stack pointer points to the next entry, which one is to be executed, next entry. That is nothing but a stack pointer. So stack pointer points to the current address of the next entry in the kernel or user stack. Okay, so that is the stack pointer. And lastly, it contains the general purpose register that contains the data generated by process during its execution. So these all are nothing but the contents of register context. Okay, pahle humne kya dekha? First of all, we have seen the user stack, user level context. Then second one is the register level context. Under register level context, we have seen the program counter, the process status register, the stack pointer, and the general purpose register. Okay, now next, here, the next one is the static part. Okay, here, there is a system level context, no? Third one is the system level context. The kernel data structure that relates to the process is called as system level context. So what it contains here? The system level context. System level context has static part and dynamic part. Two parts are there, static part and dynamic part. Okay, a process has one static part throughout its lifetime. Static means it is same for same throughout the lifetime of the process. Lifetime means up to the end of the process, termination of the process, the static part is constant. That is not changing. The process has one static part throughout its lifetime, but it can have variable number of dynamic parts. Dynamic means the part which is changing, repeatedly it is changing. Okay, throughout the lifetime of the process, the dynamic part is changing. That is called as a dynamic part of the process. And first one is the static part of the process. So we are talking about the system level context, where the static part and the dynamic parts are there. Static part is same throughout the system lifetime, process lifetime, and the dynamic part is changing. It is variable. Okay, it can variable number of a the process can have a number of dynamic parts. Okay, variable number of dynamic parts. Now, first one we will see. First static part is shown here. First, the static part consists of the following components. What it contains: the process table entry, the U area, the prigen. Prigen means per process region table. Prigen is nothing but per process region table. So the prigen entries and the region table and the page table, all these three things are static. Okay, so what is the static part of the process? Static part of the process, the process table entry, the U area, and the prigen entries and the region table and the page table are static in nature. Okay, so are you getting what I'm saying? What are the static part of the process? What are the static part of the process? The process table entry,
The U area table entry
and the prison entries, region table and the page table are the static part of the process. Okay, that is nothing but a system level context. Okay, don't forget our topic name, system level context. The first system level context is static part. Static part contains process table entry, U area and region entries and region table and page table. Okay, now next, dynamic part. What the dynamic part consists of? Okay, dynamic part means what? Dynamic part is not constant throughout the execution of the process. It is changing. It is changing from one state to another state. Whenever the process is executing from creation to the termination, okay, number of states are there. The throughout its lifetime, the dynamic part is changing. Okay, so now you can see what the dynamic part consists of. The dynamic part of the process consists of the following component. First one is the kernel stack. Okay, it contains the kernel stack, which contains the stack frame, the kernel functions. Okay, stack frame. So logical frames are there, logical stack frames are there, which are available on the kernel stack. Okay, which are available on the kernel stack. In the unit number 2, we have seen this. The kernel stack contains the stack frames, the kernel functions. If all the processes share the kernel text and data, kernel stack needs to be different for all the processes, as every process might be in the different state depending on the system called it executes. Okay, here every process is having a different state depending upon the system called it execute. Okay, and depending upon the state of the process, the kernel stack is changing. Kernel stack, and what it contains? It contains the logical stack frame, which is having a actual kernel functions. Whenever in the unit number 2 we have seen the logical stack means what? A stack is automatically created and its size is dynamically changing. Okay, this sentence we have seen in the unit number 2. The stack is automatically created. When it will be created? The stack will be automatically created and its size will be dynamically changed. So what is the meaning of this? Can anybody explain how the size of the stack can change dynamically? Okay, if you remember unit number 2, how the size of the stack will change dynamically. Can anybody reply? How the size of the stack change dynamically? See, you start preparation. It's very important to start your subject preparation. In the unit number, during the function call, correct? Siddhant is given a correct answer. During a function call, whenever the function is called, then the logical stack frame will be pushed onto the stack. And whenever the function returns some value, then the logical stack frame will be pop. Okay, so these are the two operations, push and pop. Okay, so the push and pop means the size of the stack will dynamically change whenever the function will call and function returns the value. So function returns the value means, so after completing the execution, every function returns some value. Okay, so jab uska execution khatam ho jayega, then it returns some value. So that time the logical stack frame will be pop. Okay, and whenever the function is called, the logical stack frame will be push. So this is the push and the pop operation that can take place with the help of this kernel stack, and that's why it is known as the stack is automatically created and its size is dynamically changed. When it will be changed? When the function is called, the size will be increasing. The function is returning the value, the size will be decreasing. That means the push and the pop operation. समझ में आ रहा है सबको? So that is dynamic. That is dynamic in nature. That is not static. Throughout the lifetime of the process, the state of the process is changing. Why the state of the process is changing? It's changing because of the system call. Whenever the process execute the system call, the state of the process is changing. And whenever the state is changing, the kernel stack is also changing. So that's why it is dynamic. Okay? That's why it is dynamic. And opposite to this, if you see the static part mein kya hai? Static part mein hai the process table entry, the U area, and the region entries, region table and the page table are static in nature. They are not changing. Their size is not changing. Their contents are not changing. They are static throughout the lifetime of the process. And the dynamic part, like first one is the kernel stack. Okay? It is dynamic in nature. Okay? Just a minute. See, so what we are saying, we are discussing the kernel stack, which is dynamic in nature. Now you can see the next line, where a dynamic part of the system level context consists of the dynamic part of the system level context consists of set of layers, okay, which are visualized as a last in first out, okay, because it is stack. So what it contains? It contains the logical stack frames, which are last in first out nature. We know the property of stack, last in first out. Okay. So each system level context layer contains the information necessary to recover the previous layer, including the register context of the previous layer. Okay. So that is there. And here you can read the push and pop operation related to the kernel stack. Whenever, as I said, function is called, the logical stack frame will be pushed. Whenever the function is returning value, the logical stack frame will be popped. Okay, so that is there. Now this thing is explained with the help of this figure. You can see the following figure shows the component that form the context of the process. Very important figure. Component of the context of the process. How many contexts are there? Three contexts are there. First one is user level context. Second one is register level context. Third one is kernel level context. So this figure gives you the components of all these context of the process. So you can see in the figure on the left hand side, the static portion of the context. Okay. The static portion of the context is shown. And the right hand side, the dynamic portion of the context is shown. Okay. So the screen is visible to everybody. Are you able to see the screen? Yes or no? Yes. So see the figure clearly. It shows the component that form the context of the process. Aapko question aayega, what is the context of the process? Definitely there will be a question in the examination. What is the context of the process? The context of the process contains the three fields, okay, user level context, register level context, and system level context. So you can see the static portion of the context, that is a user level context. It contains the process state, data, stack, and shared data. Then the static part of the system level context, static part are what? Process table entry, U area, region table. Okay, all these are nothing but the static part of the system level context, whereas the dynamic part is nothing but the kernel stack, which contains the logical stack frame. You can see what is this already we have seen. Okay, so see the figure clearly, and if you are facing any difficulty to understand the meaning or the concept of this context of the process. You can ask the question right now, or later on also you can send me the message regarding your doubts and query. Okay. See the figure clearly. This is nothing but the components of the context of the process. Any problem to anybody? Any difficulty to understand? If you are facing any problem, you can ask the question. Is anybody having any problem related to the context of the process? What is the context of the process? What it contains? What is the context of the process? And what are the components of the context of the process? After question aayega, what is the process context? Or context of the process. There you have to explain the detail with the help of this figure. Okay. Then again, what is the static part? What is the dynamic part? Okay. How this dynamic part can be changing its size? How the dynamic part is changing the size that we know when the push and the pop operation, when the function is called, when the function is called, the stack frame will be pushed and the function is written. The stack frame will be popped, and this happens in the fashion last in first out, last in first out, because it is a stack. Stack is having only one end. Stack is having only one end. Okay, it is one end means from where you can insert the stack frame and from where you can remove the stack frame. So that's why it is a last in first out, last in first out manner. Okay. किसी को कुछ डिफिकल्टी है इन द कॉन्टेक्स्ट ऑफ द प्रोसेस? ऑल दिस थिंग्स आर एक्सप्लेन्ड हियर. ओके, नाउ नेक्स्ट पॉइंट इज सेविंग द कॉन्टेक्स्ट ऑफ द प्रोसेस. सेविंग द कॉन्टेक्स्ट ऑफ द प्रोसेस, व्हाट इज द मीनिंग ऑफ दिस सेविंग द कॉन्टेक्स्ट? सो ऑपरेटिंग सिस्टम और द कर्नल. Kernel has to save the context of the process. Operating system has to save the context of the process. Okay, so why it is necessary, how to save the context, and for what purpose it will be useful, that all things we are going to discuss in this article, saving the context of the process. Saving the context of the process. Okay, let's see here. Now, as in the previous section, we have seen the kernel saves the context of the process whenever it push a new system context layer. Okay, whenever a new system context layer is pushed, the context of the process will be saved by the kernel. In particular, this happens when the system receives the interrupt, or when a process execute a system call, or when a kernel does the context switch. Okay, three things are there. Three things are there when the process can, kernel can save the context of the process. Okay, three things are there, or three situations, I can call it as a situation, or three scenarios are there that time the context of the process can be saved by the kernel. Who will save the context of the process? Who will save? The kernel will save the context of the process, and this context will be saved whenever the interrupt or the exception occur. Whenever the interrupt or the exception occurred, then the context of the process will be saved. Secondly, when the process execute a system call, whenever the system call is executed by the process, the context of the process will be saved. And third scenario is whenever the process, or whenever the kernel is doing the context switch, whenever the kernel does the context switch, then that time the context of the process will be saved. Okay, samajh mein aa raha hai sabko? Are you getting what I am saying?
Okay, what are the scenarios when the context of the process will be saved?
Three scenarios are there that we are going to learn in deep. That is what happened when the interrupt and the exception occurred. Secondly, what happened when the system called executed, and what happened when the kernel performed the context switch. So three things are there. That time the context of the process will be saved. That time the context of the process will be saved.
Okay. Interrupt and exception. Interrupt and exception. This is the first context. First scenario to save the context of the process. In the unit number one, under the article assumption about hardware. Assumption about hardware, there we have seen the interrupt and exception. So what is the interrupt and exception? Okay, what is the interrupt and exception that we have seen in the unit number one? What is the interrupt? Can anybody explain what is the interrupt and what is the exception? What is the interrupt and exception? Anybody can reply what is meant by interrupt and exception? Yuvraj is saying that is a system called interrupt. Interrupt is not a system call. See, Prathamesh is saying that the interrupt occurred due to the external thing. Like if you want user to input something. So he is saying that interrupt occurred due to the external thing. That is true. Interrupt is externally occurred. Okay. So whenever the program is under execution or the process is executing and suddenly an interrupt occurred. Suddenly the interrupt occurred. In the unit number one, we have seen the types of the interrupts. What are the types of the interrupts and exceptions? And what are its priority? What are its priority? So which one is having a highest priority and which one is having a lowest priority? Highest priority and the lowest priority. If you remember, the highest priority interrupt and the lowest priority interrupt. Okay. What is the highest priority interrupt? Okay. That is called as the interrupt levels. Interrupt levels. Interrupt levels. So the highest priority, that is the priority number one, goes to the machine errors. Machine errors. That is the highest priority interrupt. Okay, machine errors. Second one is the clock interrupt. Clock. System clock is nothing but an interrupt. Okay. Then the disk interrupt. Then the network devices. And the lower priority is the terminal. And the last priority is the software interrupts. Okay. So these are the levels of the interrupt that we have seen in the unit number one. So why I am asking here? Because whenever this interrupts or the exception occurs, then the context of the process will be saved. Our topic kya hai? What is the topic of the discussion? When to save the context of the process? Okay, everybody see, everybody listen me clearly. When? कब आपको कॉन्टेक्स्ट ऑफ द प्रोसेस सेव करनी है? ओके, ऊपर हमने देखा व्हाट इज द मीनिंग ऑफ कॉन्टेक्स्ट ऑफ द प्रोसेस. अभी हम पढ़ रहे हैं व्हेन टू सेव द कॉन्टेक्स्ट ऑफ द प्रोसेस. सो द फर्स्ट सिनेरियो इज व्हेन द इंटरप्ट्स एंड द एक्सेप्शन ऑकर्ड, दैट टाइम द कॉन्टेक्स्ट ऑफ द प्रोसेस विल बी सेव्ड. सो यू कैन सी हियर द सिस्टम इज रिस्पॉन्सिबल फॉर हैंडलिंग द इंटरप्ट्स एंड एक्सेप्शन. इट इज ट्रू. Yes, it is absolutely right that the system is responsible for handling the interrupts and exception. So what are the interrupts and exceptions? Machine errors, clock interrupt, then terminal, disk, software interrupt, all these are nothing but the interrupts and the exceptions that are the responsibility of the system to handle these interrupts and exceptions. Here, if the system is executing at a lower processor execution level, when an interrupt occurs, the kernel attempts the interrupt before decoding the next instruction and raise the processor execution level to block other interrupt of that or lower level. It handles the interrupt by performing the following sequence of operation. So jab interrupt occur hota hai to kya hota hai? So whenever the interrupt is occur, then the kernel means a system, operating system. System is executing at a lower processor execution level. And when the interrupt occurs, the kernel attempts the interrupt. Kernel attempts the interrupt means, attempts means it is servicing the interrupt. It is giving a service to that interrupt. Okay. So it's the responsibility of the kernel to serve that interrupt. Okay. So it stops the execution. Current execution will be stopped. Current execution will be stopped and it attempts that interrupt. Okay. It handles the interrupt by performing the following sequence. So what are the sequence here? First one. So first thing is that kernel saves the current register context of executing process and creates push a next context layer. Okay. Kernel kya karega? Kernel will save the current register context. और ऊपर हमने देखा है व्हाट इज द रजिस्टर कॉन्टेक्स्ट. कर्नल विल सेव द करंट रजिस्टर कॉन्टेक्स्ट ऑफ एग्जीक्यूटिंग प्रोसेस एंड क्रिएट्स अ न्यू कॉन्टेक्स्ट लेयर एंड क्रिएट अ न्यू कॉन्टेक्स्ट लेयर. सेकंड, द कर्नल डिटरमाइंस द सोर्स दैट इज द कॉज ऑफ द इंटरप्ट. व्हाट इज द कॉज और व्हाट इज द सोर्स ऑफ द इंटरप्ट. ओके, सो कर्नल डिटरमाइंस फ्रॉम वेयर द इंटरप्ट कम्स. That what is the cause of the interrupt, and if applicable, a unit number such as which drive caused the interrupt. Okay, when a system receives an interrupt, it gets a number. It uses that number as an index into interrupt vector, which stores the action to be taken. That is called as interrupt handler. When interrupt occur, for example, now interrupt vector is shown here. Here. The sample interrupt vector, okay, that is this sample interrupt vector is not available in this PPT. That is available in the book. The sample interrupt, that means what this vector contains, it contains the interrupt number. Every interrupt is having an interrupt number. Every interrupt is having an interrupt number and a interrupt handler. Interrupt handler. Like for example, let me tell you. Or in the next lecture, I will show you the actual figure of this sample interrupt vector, where interrupt number zero is used for clock interrupt. Okay, interrupt number one is used for disk interrupt. Interrupt number two is used for terminal interrupt, TTY. Then third is used for device interrupt. Fourth one is used for software interrupt, and fifth one is used for other interrupt. That is a sample interrupt vector. Sample interrupt vector. Okay. So these two things will be done. Two things will be initially done whenever the interrupt is occur. So firstly, kya karega? Firstly, it saves the current register context of the executing process. And secondly, it find out the source of the interrupt. Each interrupt is having a interrupt number and the interrupt handlers. Okay, interrupt handlers ka matlab kya hai? Interrupt handler routines. So jab interrupt occur hoga to kaun sa routines, which routines are need to be executed, that is nothing but interrupt handlers. Okay, when the interrupt occurs. Now instead of this figure there is a interrupt vector. That next time I will change this figure, because this is not interrupt vector. Interrupt vector, it contains the interrupt number and the interrupt handler. Okay, that I will show you in the next lecture. Then next third thing, Third thing the kernel can do, the kernel invoke the interrupt handler. Once the kernel got the interrupt number, एक बार kernel को interrupt number मिल चुका है तो उसके बाद वो क्या करेगा, kernel invoke, invoke means it execute the interrupt handler, okay, interrupt handler. And the last one is the kernel returns from the interrupt handler and execute the set of hardware instructions which are restored in the previous context. See here, interrupt handler routine execute होने के बाद kernel क्या करेगा, kernel returns from that interrupt handler and execute the set of hardware instruction which restore the previous context. Okay, so these are nothing but the four operations, four sequence of operations that can be take place by the kernel whenever the interrupt or the exception occurs. Okay, now here one algorithm is shown, that is the algorithm for interrupt handling. Okay, algorithm for interrupt handling, and you can see the name of the algorithm is INT hand, that is interrupt handler. Input is none, output is none, and the first step is save the current context, determine the cause of the interrupt, find the interrupt vector, call the interrupt handler, and restore the previous context layer. So see here, my dear student, with the help of this algorithm, you can easily remember what is the context of the process will be saved whenever the interrupts and the exception occurred. Okay, so just remember this algorithm. And then here you can see the example of interrupts. So see here, clock interrupts are there, disk interrupts are there, then the system called and the user layer. So here we will stop because our time is finished. Okay, in the next lecture we will see the second scenario, what happened when the system called, what happened when the system called execute. Okay, so now I will take the attendance. Okay, and then after you can leave the meeting and join the next class. Okay, so one by one I will call the number and you just give your attendance. Roll number 82.
Present, sir.
Okay. 83.
Present, sir.
84.
Present, sir.
85.
Present, sir.
86.
Present, sir.
87.
Present, sir.
88.
Present, sir.
89. 90.
Present, sir.
91.
Present, sir.
92.
Present, sir.
93.
Present, sir.
94. 94. 95.
Present, sir.
96.
Present, sir.
97.
Present, sir.
99.
Present, sir. Present, sir.
Present, sir.
101.
Present, sir.
102. 103. 104. 105. 106.
Present, sir.
107. 108. 109.
Present, sir.
110.
Present, sir.
11.
Present, sir.
12.
Present.
13. 14.
Present, sir.
15.
Present, sir.
16. 16, 17, 18,
present, sir.
19, 20,
present, sir.
21,
present, sir.
22, 23,
present, sir.
24 25
present sir
26 27 28
present
29
present sir
30
present
31
present sir
32 33
present sir
34
present sir
35 36
present sir
37 38 39 40
present sir
41 42 43 44 45
present sir
46
present sir
47 48 49
present sir
present sir
48 148 149
present sir
50 51 52
present sir
53
present sir
54
present sir
55 56 57 58
present sir
58 is there okay 62
yes sir
62 63
present sir
76
no direct second year
direct second year 176 177 78 79 80 81 82 83 84 anybody present no okay thank you very much for joining the meeting